Well, morning everybody, it's good to be with you again. It's Sunday the 29th of March, and if you remembered to change your clocks last night, then it's around about 10:30, though you might not be watching this live, and if you forgot to change your clocks last night, you might be watching it much later. But anyway, it's good to be with you again. This morning, David is going to be speaking to us later. And we're going to, first of all, just share in a few songs, time of praise and worship together, and sharing a few encouraging words from the Bible together. And then we will hand over to David. So we're going to start this morning. This is a song that's just kept on coming back into my head this week. It's an older song, but it's all about bringing everything to the Lord in prayer. And it's the song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. So please sing at the top of your voices, and let's sing this together, and remember that we can bring everything to God in prayer. Take everything to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray together now. Lord, we thank you that we can bring everything to you in prayer. Thank you that at the moment life is very different to usual. For some people, life is really, really difficult at the moment. Thank you that we can bring everything to you in prayer, knowing that you are with us, that you are by our side, that you are strengthening us and encouraging us and walking with us. And Lord, when we are crying, you are crying with us. When we are laughing, you are laughing with us. When we're downhearted, you are there putting your arm around us. Lord, we thank you that we can bring everything to you in prayer. This morning, as we praise together, as we worship together, although we can't be together physically, thank you that through technology we can be together, sharing together. Thank you that you've given us the ability to be able to use this technology. And Lord, as we learn together from your word a little bit later on, we pray that you will bless us, that you will encourage us, that you will inspire us, that you will challenge us. Lord, this morning we want to pray particularly for our friends and our families. Some of us are struggling with not being able to see our families and our friends at the moment. But Lord, we pray that we will be satisfied in the knowledge that they're safe and well. Lord, we are also aware of those that are not well. Maybe people that we know, just maybe people in our communities, some of whom are seriously ill. And Lord, we lift them to you. Lord, we ask for your healing. We ask for your comfort. We ask for a sense of your presence. And Lord, we are aware that this pandemic is sweeping the world. And people across the world are struggling to come to terms with this and to try to deal with this. And Lord, it's hard enough in a country like ours when we have so many things at our disposal that we can use. We're still struggling. But in other countries where they don't have the medical equipment and the medical people like we do, they are struggling and they're going to be struggling even more. Lord, we ask for your mercy. We ask that you will quickly help us as a world to be able to get this under control. And Lord, we ask at this time that people will reach out to you. Lord, we know that sometimes people blame you when things go wrong. But I pray that people won't blame you, but that people will reach out to you for your love, for your comfort, for your mercy, for your grace. Lord, again, I just ask now that you will be with us during this time together, that everybody who manages to see this or listen to this will really find it an encouragement this morning and a blessing. Thank you for your love for us, Lord. Thank you that we can bring everything to you in prayer. Amen. Talking of prayer, on Tuesday evening, those of us that are on WhatsApp managed to have a prayer time via WhatsApp, and the phone was just going ping, 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 ping as everybody was sending their messages through. But it was really encouraging to know that lots of people in the church were praying at the same time. I'm aware that not everybody watching this morning has got the same technology. If you've got WhatsApp and you weren't included in that, it's because I haven't got your number. So let me have your number and then I can add you to that WhatsApp group. It needs to be a mobile phone that's got WhatsApp on it. But also, there are people in our church that don't have any of this technology at all. We're going to be putting these services onto CDs and DVDs for those people so that at least they'll be able to watch them back afterwards. But if you can think of people in the church that don't have this technology, they probably need phone calls, and maybe they'd even like you to pray with them down the phone. I don't think there's anybody in the church that doesn't have a phone, so please do keep in touch with one another and phone each other up regularly. And some of us are phoning around, the church council are phoning around and trying to make sure that we phone everybody in the church to make sure everybody's contacted. You can phone us as well. We like to have your encouragement as well. And we'd like to hear about how you're doing. Don't just sit waiting for somebody to phone. Pick up the phone and phone somebody else. Also talking about prayer, Jeremy's going to come and do a Bible reading for us, which is kind of related to how we pray for one another at this time. Thank you, Jeremy.
Hi. Well, I'm reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians. And I'm reading from the New Century Version. And on this particular publication, this particular copy, they've put a subheading to Philippians, which says, serve others with joy. Not this joy, although it does have a capital J. Serve others with joy. And that's essentially what, that's the crux of what this little extract is about. So Paul wrote this to the Philippians hundreds of years ago, but it's very applicable to us today. So first chapter of Philippians, starting at verse 3. I thank you, God, every time I remember you, always praying with joy for all of you, I thank God for the help you gave me while I preached the good news. Help you gave from the first day you believed until now. God began doing a good work in you, and I am sure he will continue it until it is finished when Jesus Christ comes again. And I know that I am right to think like this about all of you, because I have you in my heart. All of you share in God's grace with me while I'm in prison and while I'm defending and proving the truth of the good news. God knows that I want to see you very much because I love all of you with the love of Christ Jesus. This is my prayer for you, that your love will grow more and more, that you will have knowledge and understanding with your love, that you will see the difference between good and bad and will choose the good, that you will be pure without wrong for the coming of Christ, that you will do many good things with the help of Christ to bring glory and praise to God. That's Philippians chapter 1, 3 to 11.
Thank you, Jeremy. I hope those words have been an encouragement to you this morning. One other notice that I wanted to share with you, this evening at 6:30, we're going to try and do a communion service together. Obviously, we can't be together to share bread and wine together, but we can be together through technology. Now, John Neal is going to host this from his home on something called Zoom, which I'd never heard of a few weeks ago, but this is a way that we can see each other, and if you've got a camera, we can see each other and hear each other and just share in a time together. We will be sending out, if you haven't already received them, we will be sending out very clear instructions of how you can get onto Zoom if you've got a computer, so how you can be part of that. So keep looking out, and we'll be sending those instructions out. We're going to sing a couple more songs together this morning before we hand over to David to speak to us. The first one we're going to do is the song Praise is Rising. Next Sunday will be Palm Sunday, and this song always makes me think about Palm Sunday because it says, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. But I just want to draw your attention to a couple of other lines before we sing this together this morning. It says, because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. I've had days when I have felt really down, but God gives us that strength to face the day, and he gives us each other to encourage one another. And then it says this, in your presence, all our fears are washed away. You know, fear is actually something that can be good. At times like this, we need to be afraid of what's happening because that's what makes us cautious and careful. And it's not that God stops us fearing these things. It's not that he stops us from being cautious and careful. It's the fact that he holds us with those fears, and he sees us through, and he carries us through. He doesn't just take all fear, but he is there in that fear. And we don't have to let that fear drag us down. Use it to make us cautious, careful, wise, but we don't have to use it to drag us down. So in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're handed over to you. So I read a verse last night that said from 1 Peter, and it said, cast your cares onto Jesus because he cares for you. Cast your burdens onto Jesus because he cares for you. So let's sing this together. Praise is rising.
Oh,
We're going to be handing over to David to speak, and here's a photo of David taken a few years back now, so he looks a bit younger, but David's spoken in front of a screen with a scene on it today, so rather than seeing him you'll see a screen of a country scene, I think it is. So just before we hand over to David, let's sing one more song together. Let's sing the song Be Still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here, and then we'll hand over.
Thank you. Hello, it's great to be able to just share with you now online. And we've kind of, with all the events of things that have been taking place, suddenly it's almost as if Easter is upon us and we've missed the kind of preparation for it in many ways. Next Sunday will be Palm Sunday and then followed by Easter Sunday. What I'd like to do now is to spend time just sharing with you really kind of the event that kicks off the whole of the Easter celebration as the church looks at it and remembers it, and that is the temptation of Jesus. And so I'd like to think about that, take us right back to the start of what the main Christian church refers to as the Lenten period, but that preparation as we're leading up to Easter. I'd just like to start by just praying, though, as we look at God's word. This is very strange, talking and not actually seeing anybody. I'll let you into a secret. I'm actually in the garden shed because it's the quietest place I can be. The front room has been turned into an office because my eldest son is working at home. My youngest son is writing his dissertations for a university. So this happens to be the quietest place. Let's just pray. Lord, as we just come now to look at your word, pray that it will just be your truths that rest with us. Pray that as we hear your word specifically, that you will just speak to us through that. And as we share thoughts, Lord, we so much desire to learn from you, to be in your presence. And Lord, we thank you that you have good and great things for us. So we just, I just commit this time to you right now, Lord, asking for your blessing and for your help by the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. The temptation of Jesus is recorded in the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark and Luke. Mark just has a very brief mention of it, talking about 40 days and being in the presence of wild animals and Jesus coming to attend. The other two versions are more detailed. They reverse a couple of the temptations in different orders, but I'd like to read the account from Matthew's Gospel. So we're looking at Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4 and verses 1 to 11. Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 to 11. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." And Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. Well, I don't know about you, but kind of the supermarkets have been bare, but before everything happened, it was, believe it or not, back a few weeks ago, Shrove Tuesday, Pancake Day. And I just wondered how many people that were grabbing pancakes and mixes to make pancakes really realise what it's all about. Things have changed, haven't they? We kind of forget some of those meanings. The word Shrove, evidently, we're told by those that have studied these things, means it comes from the word shrive, meaning to absolve. It should have been the start of a time for believers to self-examine, to repent of the things that they know were wrong and not following God. Almost kind of engaging in a spiritual MOT, as it were. just looking more closely. And kind of, if you're into to work and businesses, you know, very often you have to have appraisal meetings. Where are you at now? Where do you need to be? And so the start of the Lenten period, starting at Shrove Tuesday, was that kind of focus for those that believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's recorded as early as 1000 AD. It grew into more focus and popularity in the Middle Ages. And in Great Britain, the idea of pancakes became very popular, using up eggs and fat and butter to have a feast before the Lenten period went into a time of reflection and giving up things. In Great Britain, it was evidently once a half holiday. I'm not old enough to remember that, I don't think. But churches would ring a bell, which was the Shrove bell, at 11 o'clock, and that was when everybody could down their tools, finish work for the day, and they'd go off and have celebrations. And so the story goes that some lady ran off with her pancakes that she was cooking towards the church and was tossing them up and down, and so we kind of ended up with pancake races. Of course, the day after that became Ash Wednesday, the start of the 40 days of Lent, starting with that idea of thinking about the temptation of Jesus as the key focus. It was often taken as a day of fasting. It's quite interesting that evidently fasting defined by certain main churches was actually a light breakfast, one full meal and one half meal, and not having any meat on Fridays. I think I could adopt that kind of fasting. Other churches would go through the ceremony of making the mark of a cross made from the burnt ashes from the palm leaves that were used in the previous year's service. And I taught at a school where that took place on Ash Wednesday as part of a service. The idea of the word Lent, often people wonder what that means, but it kind of is based on a Latin phrase for 40th, but it also has the English meaning of just being the spring season. But these 40 days take their significance from the day that Jesus went out into the wilderness fasting and was being tempted by Satan in that wilderness. The account that we've just read from Matthew's Gospel is at the start of Jesus's ministry. He'd been baptised by John the Baptist, and at that point, remember, we witnessed the Trinity, the voice of the Father, the dove descending, the Holy Spirit in the symbol of the dove, and Jesus himself, Father, Son and Holy Spirit. And it's kind of the preparation that Jesus starts to make before embarking on his kind of three-year ministry, culminating in his death and his resurrection. And it's a time that Satan comes, the devil comes to seek and dissuade and destroy Jesus's credibility. You see, if the devil can take Jesus, can make Jesus sin, the whole rescue plan of salvation is just blown out of the water. But it's not the only time that Satan comes and tries to cause Jesus to stumble. We can read other accounts as well. In Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, he then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. When Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." And of course, also that strong temptation that comes when Jesus is on the Mount of Olives. In Luke's Gospel, chapter 22, he withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Kind of times in which Jesus was coming under, in some ways, attack. to try and dissuade him from what he needed to do. But of course, he was faithful and obedient to his father. A kind of Jesus recognized the subtlety of the attack. And so he rebukes Satan. And as we read there, he seeks the solace of his father. See, Jesus didn't enter into ministry, public ministry, at an easy time within the nation that was there. There was a lot going on socially and politically. People were excited. John, as we said, had been baptizing, and people were looking for a religious answer or some kind of revelation. They wanted to be released from the suppression of the Romans. Just as God had rescued them in the past from Egypt, they were looking for God to send the Messiah to rescue them from the oppression and suppression of the Roman Empire. Herod, the king, was aggressive and greedy and extravagant. There was lots of friction between the various representatives in the Roman courts, the procurators. There'd been a procurator called Gratus, and he was being succeeded by Pilate. And so there was all this instability and turmoil. And Jesus, God with all the power of a creator at hand, takes his human self and he goes into the desert to prepare. And then Satan can just come along and hit Jesus with temptations that would try and sort out everything there and then. It was a chance to take that shortcut, avoid all that hard work and suffering. This is what Satan, the devil, can say to Jesus. By offering him these temptations. Come on, you don't need to go through all this. We can do it this way. This is the easy way. You know, I wonder how many of us kind of often, when it comes to difficulties, we want to take the easy route. I often wonder why with architects, they build some great designs. And when they put paths around buildings that they've designed, very often those paths are always kind of square and follow the edges of the building. And of course, nobody actually walks to them. If you want to get from A to B, you take the shortest route. Jesus knew that he couldn't take the shortest route. He had to take the hard route, which was the right route. And so what we have, that these temptations are trying to destroy who the Messiah is. It was kind of, the devil was resting all his kind of cards, if you like, playing his cards to destroy who the Messiah was, who Jesus was going to be. He was used trying to get Jesus to misuse his power of self-gratification so that Jesus would do things for himself, to try and get Jesus to become popular by playing to the crowd with kind of miracles as if doing magic tricks. And he was trying to get Jesus to sell his soul to the devil, to himself, so that it would compromise the whole deal, as it were. You know, physically, 40 days, we're told, is about the limit that a human can go without food, as long as they're still having water. Without water, it's a much shorter period. So physically, towards those end of 40 days, Jesus, as a human, would be really physically suffering. He's at the lowest point. And Satan comes in. Remember Job in the Old Testament and how Job is afflicted? And it's kind of the low point where Satan is trying to get Job to destroy his testimony with God. And it's the same thing here. So there's Jesus. And he's in the desert of Judea. And the desert of Judea lay between Jerusalem and the Dead Sea. And as we said, the body and the mind were at its weakest point. Jesus would have been struggling very physically. And so the devil comes and he offers these easy solutions, but with gravitas consequence, because your salvation and my salvation rested upon what Jesus went through. It would have just totally destroyed God's plan for salvation. As I say, the temptations that are recorded, as you read from Luke's Gospel, but in Matthew's Gospel, we have two of the verses swapped around. But in verse 3, we read about that the tempter comes and says, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." This little verse needs a little explanation. If you read it, it's not it sometimes looks as if it's trying to, you know, get Jesus to doubt who he is. And I don't think that is the interpretation that is now seen for this piece of scripture. It should really be better interpreted or translated, and others have looked at this, as coming out as, since you are the Son of God. In other words, you are God, so it's okay to change the stones into bread, isn't it? Because since you are the Son of God, yeah, you are the Son of God, so you can do this. You can get rid of that hunger. You are the Son of God. You've got authority and power to do that. So Satan wasn't trying to make Jesus think he wasn't God. He was saying, well, look, you are God. Get on with it. You can use the power and help yourself and do all these things. So he's trying to get Jesus to use his powers for himself. You know, in the past, God provided manna in the desert, didn't he, for the Jewish people as they're wandering in the desert. Jesus was going to trust and rely on God the Father to provide what he needed at the right time. And we need to rely spiritually upon God's provision for us. Later, God sends his angels to minister and provide for Jesus' needs. God will provide for our needs, whatever they are. We have to be patient. We have to be faithful. We have to just wait. Those 40 days that we mentioned are kind of parallel to the 40 years that Israel spent in the wilderness wandering around. And we, as Moses was leading the people and as the cloud went out with the presence of God, taking them to various locations. And what does Jesus use when he has to counter the devil coming to tempt him here? Well, he quotes from Deuteronomy. He quotes the instructions that God gave to Moses all those many years ago. The instructions that God gave to Moses to tell them how the Israelites, God's chosen people, should live their lives. In verse 5, it talks about the holy city, Jerusalem. The temple had been rebuilt and a courtyard had been made, which extended on an elevated platform over the kind of the edge of the landscape towards the southeast. And that made it a drop in the Kidron Valley of some 300 feet or 91 metres. Or when it talks about throwing stuff off the temple, it could have been from the top of the tower. This was about kind of using God, to get God to help you for your own needs. Jesus was being tempted to take control, to use the power. And I know sometimes, do we sometimes want to manipulate God for our own ends? You know, the world demands signs of God, doesn't it? And they're like, throwing yourself off a high place was basically saying, look at me. It was very dramatic. It was going to be an attention-grabbing kind of media stunt. People would recognise it. And people would follow Jesus. They'd think he was some kind of superstar. This was all that Satan was trying to throw at Jesus and get him to do. And note that the devil himself uses scripture, quoting from Psalm 91, but he doesn't quote it in context and he misuses that quote. Psalm 91 says, if you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you, no disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. They will tread upon the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. So again, Satan is misusing God's word. And Jesus replies, don't put the Lord your God to the test. We are called, aren't we, to just trust God and to acknowledge his faithfulness to each one of us and not try and put things to the test. You know, it's not right for us to say, oh, we are, I've got God's protection, I'm going to go and do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do this. We follow God's instructions, we are sensible in circumstances, and we know that we have a faithful God. And of course, up on the mountain, when the temptation continues, the devil reveals his hand. Worship me. This is the real kind of cheat code. This is the end game. No suffering on the cross. No cross to have to bear. You can be ruler of the world. It's all okay, Jesus. All you've got to do is bow down to me. And remember that, again, Jesus quotes from Deuteronomy. And we're reminded the devil kind of has control over the air and the kingdoms of the air, don't we, in Ephesians 2 and chapter 2. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. There is no easy route to following Jesus. We know that there is only God who is to be worshipped. It's only God who is worthy, and it is only God who we should serve. The Bible talks about the road being narrow and few enter into it, and then wide is the road that leads to destruction. You know, sports people talk about, don't they, there's no gain without pain. You know, do your exercises and you get the delayed onset muscle strain, DOMS, you know, 24 hours later and it hurts. But it's about building up. It's about strength. And what difficulties we face, God can use those. We take the narrow road. We take God's way and we worship him. There are no shortcuts to our journey, to our pilgrimage in Christ. We have to take, as it were, the rough with the smooth. But we know that nothing can separate us from the love of God. And our God is faithful. Our God is faithful. We might ask the question about whether it was real for Jesus. Jesus was fully human, and so he was sorely tested. We know that Jesus did not sin by action or inner thoughts, but his temptations were real. They weren't just symbolic. It tells us in Hebrews that Jesus was tempted in every way. And he had every opportunity, as it were, to sin, but he did not sin. In Hebrews chapter 4, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Have to kind of contrast that, don't we, with Adam right at the beginning of the Bible in Genesis. It kind of failed the test, plunged the human race into sin and ignoring God and doing their own thing. And Jesus now shows us, in resisting the temptation of the devil, that he's qualified to be the saviour. He is the Christ. Again, in Hebrews chapter 2, for this reason, he had to be made like his brothers in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. Jesus is our model for when we are being tempted. And because he fought the devil in his humanity, he shows us that it's possible for you and I to resist the devil, to resist temptation. And how does he show us? Not by using his superpowers, which he is, like Superman and Iron Man and everything else rolled into one. God doesn't do that. Jesus doesn't do that. What does he do? He uses the word of God. he uses the word of God. In Ephesians chapter 6, therefore put on the full armour of God, so that when the day of the evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with a breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. As we said, Jesus used words that were verses from the Old Testament, from Deuteronomy. And in Deuteronomy and chapter 8, just share a couple of these. Be careful to follow every command I am giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land the Lord promised on oath to your forefathers. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Your clothes did not wear out and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. And in Deuteronomy chapter 6, fear the Lord your God, serve him only, and take your oaths in his name. Do not follow other gods, the gods of the peoples around you, for the Lord your God who is among you is a jealous God, and his anger will burn against you, and he will destroy you from the face of the land. Do not test the Lord your God as you did at Massa. So you see, Jesus uses God's word. He uses it. And so should we. You know, we can all be tempted, and we are tempted, aren't we? And sometimes God can test us during that. But it's only the devil who will tempt us to evil. And when those temptations do come, sometimes they will come when we have made a declaration for God in some way, when we stood out for God, and then kind of the attack sometimes comes to kind of knock us down, because the devil doesn't want us to be effective. He doesn't want us to be worshippers of Jesus, followers of Jesus. And he wants to cause doubt to come into our minds. He wants us to be fearful. And so we need to stand strong. And again, stand. And often that attack that Satan sends at us when we stand for Jesus comes in the form of temptation. It tells us that Jesus had angels at the end to come and meet his needs. And that's a whole other story, because, you know, angels sometimes come and meet our needs. And maybe we've experienced it when we've been trying to get things over these last few weeks and it's been difficult. God has intervened and we've not totally been aware of how God has helped us. Sometimes it has been, and I'm sure has been, through angels coming to minister to us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, just to remind us of that. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the fulfillment of the ages has come. So, if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. God is going to provide us with that way out of those temptations that we sometimes face. Temptation, remember, it only becomes a sin when we succumb. And that ultimately, isn't it, is a matter of choice. Remember, we talk about, you know, you put a plate of cakes into a room with children and you say, look, just leave that alone. I'm just going out. And you leave the room And of course, what happens? Children get tempted and somebody scoffs the cake. When a child takes a cake there, it's not a reflex action like blinking. They've just automatically got to take the cake. It's a conscious decision that they have made. We can't make an excuse, can we, for succumbing to our temptation? It is our choice. And sometimes those choices are hard and the temptations are great, but we can seek God's guidance in that. And we rest ourselves in God. We surround ourselves with God's word. We spend time with God. As we said, that Jesus was human and he fought the devil's attacks with words of scripture. It was a human response to fight a supernatural being. And as we said, scripture tells us of those other times when Jesus was tempted. We read them earlier. And about Peter's statement, trying to dissuade Jesus from going through the actions that he was going to go. We see it at the cross, people jeering at Jesus. Tell him, well, if you are the Son of God, you can save yourself. Right, you saved others, save yourself. Those temptations, Jesus could have just done it. He could have stepped down from the cross, sorted it all out there and then. But he didn't because, well, why? Because he loves you and he loves me. You know, we have great frailty, don't we? We're human, like Jesus, but we're not God. And so we do succumb to temptation. And, you know, and Paul kind of expresses a similar thing in his own life about not doing the things he needs to do and then doing things that he shouldn't do. It's in Romans chapter 7. And I'll just read that. But it's God's power that can intercept. And remember, it's God's forgiveness that comes, that when we do fall short, when we do succumb to temptation, God lifts us up. He forgives us and he enables us to start. And we build upon those weaknesses, those failings, so that next time we can be strong and we can advance and stand our ground, maybe just that a little longer. Because God will help us. He points us then in the right direction. And next time we're just that a little more prepared. In Romans, this is what it says, chapter 7. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For what I do is not the good I want to do. No, the evil I do not want to do, this I keep doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being I delight in God's law, for I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself in my mind am a slave to God's law, but in the sinful nature a slave to the law of sin. Do you know, we can help ourselves in facing the temptations that come our way by doing what God calls us to do, and that is to read, is to engage in God's word. We need to read it more. We need to learn part of it so that it comes to us quickly. Don't have to go and look it up. It's there. Bible verses. Why not, at this time when we having more time to ourselves, learn some scripture. Add to what you already know. Get into reading God's word in a regular way. Take a book, one of the Gospels, and read through it. They often tell us, don't they, that there's no such thing as a kind of reformed alcoholic. It's just an alcoholic is a person that hasn't had a drink today or tomorrow or a fixed period of time. Scripture tells us that we're all sinners. We've sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It's just that as Christians, as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, then we know that we are sinners who are forgiven. We're not perfect, but we are forgiven. And because Jesus resisted the devil, using God's words, then so can we. As we go into our Easter time and reflection now, we'll be thinking about the price that Christ had to pay for the salvation of the whole world. And it started by him preparing himself, resisting the devil, showing that this was a hard and long road that he was going to have to take. And the reason was simply because he loves each one of us. He loves you. He loves me. And despite all my warts and all, and all that I do wrong, and all that I don't want to do, and the things I do that I shouldn't do, I am forgiven. I am loved by God. And as a person who puts their trust in Jesus, that is what we can experience. That forgiveness, that hope, that joy, which gives us the strength to face the next day and the day after, no matter what storms hit us, no matter what comes our way, because nothing can separate us from the love of Jesus. Amen. Just want to pray. Lord, just give this all to you now. You know how difficult it is and quite strange to just talk, but thank you that, Lord, you will just take what is of you. Help us to reflect on that. And may we know your blessing. Pray that you'll just keep us safe, Lord, in these days to come. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, David. Let's say the grace together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.